With the exploration of ironstone came an increase in the industrial development of the area. There were seams running under most of Lambhill and the northern part of Postle Park, and these were mined from the 1840s. Several of the ironstone pits were linked to the Forth and Clyde Canal by private railways, most likely horse-worked, and some were linked to the mainline railways. The last of these ironstone pits to survive was located in a large area of land beside the crematorium at the end of Tresta Road. The Gilshockhill Pit was sunk in 1850 by the Summerlee Iron Company and was closed in 1897. It was reopened during World War I in 1916 by Drawn and Company as a coal mine, who later transferred it in 1921 to the Garscube Coal Co Limited. The mine was nationalised in 1947 with a new surface mine being driven the following year. Known locally as Gilshie, derived from Gilshockhill, and with a workforce of over 300 in its heyday, it finally closed its gates in 1966, and after lying abandoned, was demolished soon after. On the south side of the canal, at either end of Balmore Road, was the site of the Postle Old Quarries, part of a group of quarries in the surrounding area dating from the 18th century. Sandstone hewed out from the ground at Lambhill went on to build many tenement homes and grandiose company buildings in the city. By the mid-1800s, all but one of the quarries at Lambhill were filled in. The Pudge, described as a black, watery hole about 50 feet deep, located behind Tom's Yard, the local coal merchant in Knapdale Street, and was a source of precarious, foolhardy water recreation for youngsters, and a constant worry to their parents.
I only found out recently it was an iron ore mine in my young day. It was just a hole in the ground, and in the winter time it froze over with ice, so we skated, not with skates, just your shoes or boots. The children played with the big trees, I think they're still there, some of them, and they had ropes, and you put a brick round the rope, swung it over a strong branch, put a bit of cardboard or old carpet, and that was a swing.
And then there was another depression, a bigger depression, that went from there, about the far side of the police station, right quite far on. And that was the ashes, and it was completely different. It was ash, just ashes. It just looked machine ashes, you know, stuff like that. Black and grey and bluish, that was the ashes, and it was quite steep. And at the foot of that, there was water, but there was very little that grew in that. It was just a sort of water, dark, it was darkish water in there. And that was where you used to go down there and make rafts there. We had rafts in that. You didn't make rafts in the Pudge because it had too many wee bits of trees and willows and bits and pieces of flowers and reeds and stuff in it.
We didn't realise, of course, that it was as deep as it was. And there was a tragedy. Two brothers were drowned when the ice broke him in, and his brother went in to help him. And both. So we had, there was a procession for his funeral from the school, which was St Agnes's, across from the Pudge, right down to the Lambhill Bridge. That was a sad story.
The Pudge was finally filled in the late 1940s, and the site formed the foundation of Kingarth House, a retirement home for Lambhill's senior residents, which closed in 1990 and the site demolished in 2007. Down near the bottom of Balmore Road, next to the railway, was the Glasgow Steel Roofing Company. The company was set up in 1906. They were gas engineers as well, and made gas holders and pipes. The years before the First World War saw a growing demand for structural steelwork. and the Glasgow companies were very much in competition with Germany at that time. Another large works that had considerable impact on the area was the Lochburn Ironworks. Founded in 1877 by McFarlane Stang and Company Limited, who made cast iron water and sewage pipes of the largest size. They were specialists in producing large quantities of pipes for long-distance water-carrying systems, serving clients both at home and abroad. By 1926, they ventured into making cast iron products for the railways. At the peak of their trading, they employed over 1,000 workers. The site closed in 1929 and was cleared by 1934. Just to the west of Lochburn Ironworks were chemical works. Known as the Phoenix Chemical Works in 1896, they then became the Kelvindale Chemical Works in 1921. In 1924, the works were then known as the Lochburn Chemical Works, occupied by William Cooper and Nephews Limited, and made such products as chrysalic acid, sheep dip, disinfectant, weed killer, and soap. Lambhill Ironworks was founded in 1881 by R. Laidlaw and Sons. Laidlaws hailed from Edinburgh, where they made meters for both water and gas systems, as well as gas lamps for interior and exterior use. Laidlaws went on to become one of the biggest firms of their kind in Glasgow, operating sites at Lambhill, Port Dundas, and at the Barrowfield Works in Bridgeton. At Lambhill, they had their wharf on the bank of the canal, which allowed the supply barges to deliver their cargo of pig and malleable iron right on the foundry doorstep, until the works was later served by rail. On the 1890s Ordnance Survey, the site is shown as two separate works, Lambhill Foundry and Lambhill Forge, in Drummond Street before its name was changed to Stracker Street. R. Laidlaw and Sons made heavy equipment, such as pipes, gas holders, retort fronts, purifiers for the gas industry, as well as piers and waterworks equipment, delivering to customers all over the world. The works continued in the ownership of Laidlaw's until 1911, when it apparently closed. In 1917, the site was taken over by James Allen Sr. and Son of the Elm Bank Foundry, which was at Port Dundas and run by Allens as an iron roof, bridge and structural engineering concern. In the later stages of World War I, the factory, along with many others in Glasgow, was commissioned to the manufacture of munitions and military hardware, and women were recruited to fill the places of men who had enlisted in the armed forces. In about 1925, Allens was either sold or transformed themselves into the Lambhill Iron Works Limited. In 1931, they described themselves as garage builders, and in the 50s as specialists in theatre and cinema construction. In about 1961, the owners became Lambhill Engineering Limited.
Their offices, you can see the part of the gable end there, and that was part of the tenements at Stracker Street that stopped there. And then from the honeycombed sandstone at the bottom and the red glazed bricks, that was the Lambhill offices, which were beautiful offices. You opened the door, it was like a vegetable you went into first. We never seen anything like this. We'd think it was like something from the Greek gods, or this Roman sort of looking really beautiful marble. You know, the only time we'd see marble was when we went out to the cemetery. You went through that, and then it was a parquet wooden floor. And as you went in the door to the back of that On the wall, there was a picture had been painted from the back of the ironworks showing the guys all working, the cranes moving the steel. It really, it was something. Where that has went to now, we don't know. It spans for bridges, something like the stuff at the central station would be built on. These, you know, the big girders, all these big massive things. We always knew it was heading into the town. It might have been heading abroad or wherever. Early in the morning, you'd hear the ruckus out here. The lorry would be versing in, it'd be one of Cullen's flatbed lorries. It would come down and it would reverse in. And on the top of that, there would be two sets of wheels, big rubber wheels, and they would be rolled off. And they'd go way down into the engineering works, and the crane would put this big massive bit of metal on these flat beds, and then the lorry would come down, and it would be, the metal would be raised up again, and the lorry would go under that, and then it would start going out with a police escort. Now these beams were 40, 50 feet long, maybe two of them on going to a job somewhere. The police escort would take them back up. The lorry would turn onto Balmore Road. And then the guys had to manually, with like metal poles, to turn these wheels, and then it would move again, and then turn the other wheels, and it was something to be seen. It takes you back to the times where the Springburn locomotives were getting transported on the low loaders. No, we had our own engineering here. You know, we don't need Springburn, you know, we don't need the car, we don't need them. We had, this massive stuff was coming out of here.
The Renfrew Street footbridge leading into the Savoy Centre is one of the few remaining examples of their work and was one of the last jobs done at Lambhill Engineering before they closed in 1972. The site has now been demolished and is now the site for new housing. At the bottom of Hill End Road, a few yards from Lambhill Railway Aqueduct, is the location of a subway tunnel under the canal, which dates back to 1775 and is known locally as the Halloween Pend. As a condition of building the canal between the land of Hill End and Loch End, the canal company had to provide a tunnel for drovers who had walked their pigs, sheep and cattle over a track here from generations before. The tunnel is still accessible for pedestrians, though the passageway is hampered with mud all year round, and with only the bravest of ramblers negotiating it in complete darkness. The sunken drover's path at the Lochburn Road entrance remains an unchanged wildlife corridor, which evokes visions of herders and their livestock en route to the market in the city, or perhaps driving uphill to the watering hole at Loch End. The Halloween Pend, so aptly named, provides a daunting shortcut from Rockhill Golf Course to Lochburn Road, though this may be about to change, as there are plans at Lambhill Community Council to install lighting and make it safe for pedestrians once again.